Pashima gindi na mashiwi panono. Pashima gindi na mashiwi panono. Liashi ya panganda ikale niko panshi. Defaya mipusheko. Pashima gindi ichomulari la kunse. Yonse chishi.
Nashil Pichen Kazembe was born in 1932 near the Congolese border in Northern Province, Zambia. He had an affinity for music at an early age and taught himself how to play banjos and later guitar. In 1953, he went to work in the mines in South Africa, where he formed his first band, the Bantu Negroes, which was eventually disbanded after Kazembe returns to Zambia the following year.
Kabuita wandie ne mwine mayo Pancho nkola muri nsone mulandaye Kabuita wandi sonkune kwe filamba.
Dr. Kazembe once worked in South Africa in the mines, and that was during the Northern Rhodesia days. He came back here. Though he didn't stay for a long time, he again left. Went to Kenya. So I think by the time Kenya got independence, he was already there, he was established. The new wave of Kenyan musicians, most of them, Kazembe was respected even by musicians from Congo. Kenya had superb studios that time. A lot of musicians from Congo used to travel to go and record in Kenya. There was huge investment in Kenyan studios. I think it was second to none. No? Congo also had good studios. Kinshasa had very good studios. But with Kenya, is that there were a lot of very big studios, and the promoters were many. There were a lot of promoters in Kenya. So Kenya was more like a center it had become a center for music in Africa. We had a lot of Congolese musicians, South African musicians. They used to go there and record. But I think with Kazembe had settled there. Even before Kenya gained its independence, Zambia by the time we had Northern Rhodesia, Kazembe was already in Kenya.
His big hit, Apili Anabuela, was the first single to sell more than 50,000 units in Zambia. It was a song about Mr. Piri, a long-lost migrant worker who returns home from the city empty-handed, only to find that no one in his village remembers him.
The time Zambians got to know that there was actually a musician living in Kenya. I think it was through one of Zambia's greatest music promoters, Mr. Kuzuayo. Kuzuayo, the proprietor of Music Power. There was a time Kuzuayo had. There was a Zambian living in Kenya. He had made it big in Kenya. He was a big name in Kenya. He was singing Swahili. And of course, mixing with the other languages, the other Kenyan languages. When Kuzuayo traveled to Kenya, he arranged for studio time, and they had to convince Kazembe to do a song which they were going to sell back home in Zambia. They went into a studio and did a very good piece. When you listen to Apili Anabuela, it has that touch. You listen to the production. That song was done in 1974, but the production was superior. And you can also try to compare with the records Kazembe made when he came back to Zambia. The songs recorded at Two Records. The song we recorded in 74 actually sounded better in quality than the ones he came and did here. It was because of the good studios which Kenya had. So when Kuzuayo convinced Kazembe to record the track, that was Apili Anabuela, about an immigrant who went and then he came back. They had no relatives, no children. The song sold about over 50,000 units here. I think that gave Kazembe green light. So I think when he ran into the promoters were exploiting it. Quite alright, they had good facilities. shows they used to organize shows and the promotions, but they were just giving them peanuts. So I think the artists were now they became, I think, disgruntled. So Kazembe had to start now trying out something new. Wallace in Kenya started now mixing up with some in the album. You would do a Bemba song, sometimes even praising Kaunda, and the songs used to do very well back home. So I think in the late 70s, Kazembe decided just to come back to Zambia and do something. And here, it's obvious, we all know what he did. Tew Record Company signed him up, but he was also a producer there. He produced a couple of albums, even for other bands, those other bands which were doing Kwasi Rumba. Kazembe he was a Kwasi Rumba. What he used to do was more like Rumba, but he had mixed it with East African music. You know, he was a giant.
Oh, Regina Dada. Oh, oh, oh. Yeah, oh. Ulini omba rusa, wende nyumbani o. Kawaone wazazi, nisiku nyingi.
It was in Kenya that he developed his style of combining Zambian traditional music with Congolese, Kenyan and Southern African urban rhymes like Bemba music and Kwela. And he returned to Zambia in the 1980s and recorded further albums there and enjoyed popularity in Zimbabwe as well. Kazembe died in 1991.
So the Zambian music in the 80s took a twist. Quite right, we had very good artists in the 80s. John Mwanza was doing well. Mlemena was doing well. That's Chivangu, Brian Brown Chivangu was doing very well. The one who took over Mlemena. We had even other artists. Alfred Sarakarusa was doing also well. That was in the mid 80s. But now the economy was so bad. In the 1986 we had riots, food riots. This is a signal that the economy was down now. Musicians stopped making money. They were now relegated to performing just in nightclubs. They're just now performing in nightclubs. They just became resident bands and the money wasn't much. Just hand to mouth. So most of them, you would find most of the biographies which have been written about these artists, you'll find they would say most of them died penniless, they had no money. But they don't explain what actually led to them finding themselves in that situation. The economy was so bad. Artists stopped making money. Piracy was on the rise now. Piracy had taken a toll. It hit our industry very bad. Not only our industry, even the Congolese industry. Artists in Congo stopped making money. Artists here stopped making money. Most of Congolese artists had to relocate from Congo to Belgium. Franco, of course, had left in the early 80s, somewhere around 1980 or 1981. He had left when he set up his base in Belgium, Brussels, Belgium. Now, for those artists, most of them just had to do with music. Some of them just disappeared on the scene. That time we had no private media houses. The one which we had, the biggest, which was, of course, ZNBC, was also strained.
Tabia yako na